Hello, welcome to another episode of Celebrating Southbridge. I'm Ron Sinangelo, your host and Southbridge Town Manager. Thank you for tuning into our show. As you may know, Celebrating Southbridge is all about informing you as to what's happening here in Southbridge. We have a ton of different departments, and sometimes our citizens don't know what each department does. Tonight, I have a great guest. Heather Blakely is our DPW superintendent. She runs basically our whole DPW department, which includes things like roads and water and sewer, those kind of things. So, Heather, thank you and welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ron. Thanks for having me.
You know, it's great to have you. And I know DPW is one of my bigger departments, and you really are involved with a lot of people in different ways. So I gave a brief little bit about what the department does, but tell me about the various departments and a little bit about what a DPW director does.
Sure. So DPW is Department of Public Works. Underneath the DPW, the Department of Public Works, we have our water department, our sewer department, operations, and under operations includes roads, drainage, cemeteries, parks, building maintenance, and so we kind of touch on everything from in all of those different ranges.
Well, the big issue coming up, we all know, is the issue of snow. if there's nothing we talk about more, and this time of year, me and you, is about snow and plowing and, you know, when are our contractors going to be available? Tell me a little bit about what you do when it comes to snowstorms and how it impacts the citizens of Southbridge.
Yes, exactly. Snow is a really big topic at this time, as you said. And we have a couple of procedures that are already put in place. Starting December 1st, we have an alternate side parking ban that goes into effect. And that is all day long from 7 to at p.m. at night to 7 p.m. at night, and that is one thing that we put in place starting in December and going all the way through April 1st. In addition, we have snow emergencies, which is the next step up where we try to have all of the cars off the road on any of our snow emergency routes. But when a snowstorm is coming and it's been predicted to come, we're watching that snowstorm 2 or 3 days ahead of time, trying to figure out how much is coming, what the timing is, checking all the different stations, checking our weather reports that we get in specifically for Southbridge, and making sure that we're prepared. We make sure that all the trucks are prepared, that we know what our plan is going into it. And depending on how much snow is predicted, I will make a determination if we're going to have a snow emergency or not.
Well, let's talk about the capacity of our department, the size, so to speak. How many, you know, we see the big trucks, the big DPW trucks come around. How many of those are out on the road for that are just Southbridge Town vehicles?
Southbridge Town vehicles, we have 17 people in the department that will be out in a vehicle during a snowstorm, whether it be a loader, a large truck, or a typical pickup truck with a plow on the front of it. And at any one time, it could be only the spreaders spreading the salt, or it could be a spreader with a plow, or it could be the small plows, depending on what the situation has right then and there. But there are 17 people in the department that are qualified to drive a plow vehicle.
Now, those big trucks are a little bit different then, because you need a special kind of license to operate those big trucks.
Correct.
So how many of the big, the you know, the really large DPW trucks are there, 6 or 7 or what's that?
We have, there will be Sanders, which were most of the Sanders, in that we have on the road at one time about 8 trucks.
Okay, and those drivers are special because they have to have CDL licenses,
correct,
right? So they're under a state education program or state license program so they have to have a little more experience or a little bit more ability than somebody driving a regular pickup, right?
Correct. We have Class A and Class B drivers, all CDL licensed for the town of Southbridge of those 17 people.
You know, Heather, one of the things that I always hear from citizens is, no, how come they're not out plowing it? As soon as the first snowflake comes down, it's like, okay, get the trucks out there. Tell me a little bit, you know, one of the things that was interesting to me is how you prep for a snowstorm in terms of prepping the roads. So
right,
salt and sand early. Why do you put salt and sand on the roads before the snow even falls?
Well, the first thing we do, we only
salt. I'm sorry.
Right. We are a 100% salt community. We went to salt without a salt-sand mixture after having some educational courses. from outside teaching us about the properties and what the salt does. So we do what's called a pre-treatment. We try to get out about 3 hours ahead of a storm when it's predicted to come down. Sometimes we might be out there for the last hour when it first starts to snow, where we're treating the roads. It's pre-treatment on the roads. We want the salt to be on the road so that when the snow hits it, it melts and it forms what we call a brine, a water and salt solution that keeps the snow from adhering to the road. This prevents ice buildup on the road, and then it allows us to more easily scrape the roads when we do start plowing.
So a citizen might see, instead of a pure sheet of snow, they might see kind of like it almost looks cluttery, or
spotted effect.
Yeah.
A melted area here, a melted area there. That is because we pre-treated, and that melting is forming that brine underneath the snow.
Now that brine gives you traction. If you're driving your car, that helps give you traction versus just a solid, sheet of snow, right?
Correct.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because as I drive to work sometimes, I come through different towns, mm-hmm. and I see the differences. I could tell who has not pre-treated a road and who has just by looking at the road. You know, the roads that are not pre-treated are like almost solid ice sometimes. Mm-hmm. But when I get to Southbridge, I see that brine and I know it's a much safer travel. Is that accurate?
That is accurate for the most part. I mean, at some point the roads will become slippery again, even with the brine on it. But for the first inch to 2 inches of snow, you kind of have to let it build up a little before you start scraping, or it's really not effective. To scrape an inch of snow is very, very time consuming. And so to start when it's just first snowing, all we're doing is wasting our time, our cutting edges. The cutting edge is what the plow edges that you can replace. So you don't want to start too early. I know people do get frustrated. Why haven't you been down my road yet? Well, we're out. We just started plowing. Yes, it's accumulated. Give us a couple hours and it will be cleared off.
So let's talk. Well, let me ask you this first, because people wonder, there's an abundant more trucks when the snow gets heavier and there's more snow, right? So at first we're using a lot of town vehicles to keep the cost down, and we're using town vehicles. Mm-hmm. But at some point a decision is made to bring in the private contractors. There's a whole bunch of people we have on contract ready to help us when we need it.
Right.
Tell me about that.
So we have 13 people that we can bring on that are on contract that will add to our fleet of vehicles that we'd have out there. In addition, we have three temporary hires that we bring in to bring us up to 20 staff with us, and another two Whitewater. So employees, Whitewater being our water department, there's two employees that help come in and help us plow with water department trucks. We make that decision to go to the private outside contractors when we get to be about 3 inches. Anything under 3 inches, depending on timing, is it a storm in the middle of the night? Are we trying to get school open? Is there a reason why we need to get the snow off the off the roads quicker? But 3 inches is the kind of the benchmark that we use to call in the contractors. If it's under 3 inches and it's early on, or it's dirty, something that it's on a weekend, or timing wise that it's in the middle of the night and we can scrape it off ourselves, we're more apt to scrape it off ourselves.
It's funny, Heather, people kind of wonder why schools open and why schools close around storms and stuff. Like the superintendent kind of gets all the heat, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because they're making the call. But really, what happens before the superintendent makes the call, right? There's another conversation occurs. Tell me a little bit about that conversation between you and the superintendent, or your road crew guys and the superintendent.
Right.
How do they know when to make the decisions?
So what's interesting here in Southbridge is the buses roll out as early as 5:30 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
So that call to determine has to be made that early. So a lot of times we're looking at what the road conditions are 3 hours before that to make a determination of whether we think we can have the road safe enough for the buses to roll out at that time. The weather is unpredictable. If nothing else, it's very unpredictable.
Yeah.
It keeps us on our toes. We never want to be in a situation where we're putting in somebody in harm's way. So we are very, very conservative and cautious. Even with that, we have storms that come up we might be at great shape at 4 o'clock in the morning and be like, yeah, that's great, and then get dumped on and we're really scrambling.
Yeah.
So it's not as easy as people think. If I could predict the weather, I completely understand the concept of I wish I could predict the weather, because I'd make a lot of money on that.
There you go. I think about what happens, and I'm behind the scenes. I can see some of this stuff, right? So people think, okay, the superintendent called school. But really, in some cases, the police department, they're out in the street at night. Mm-hmm. They see the snow call down. They may call the DPW and say, hey, the snow's coming down faster than the weather report. Mm-hmm. You have been analyzing the weather report for the last couple of days. You're passing on that information to the school superintendent. The police department's giving you, you know, minute-by-minute road conditions.
Yeah. Right? Or so, my guys are. And it's the roads, you know, if we're out there, we have a really good sense of what the road conditions are. And whether, based on our timing, we think we're going to be... We would prefer not to be sending any buses out if after a snowstorm we would need to be scraped and we need to be treating roads 3 hours before that 5:30 because we need to treat.
I think sometimes people think we look out our windows and say, okay, it's snowing, it's about time to send the trucks out there. It's nothing like that. It's really well planned out, really thought
out. There's a lot of pre-planning.
A lot of discussion between a lot of different people in the morning, early in the morning, to talking about should school go on, should school not go out, what about a delay? I mean, it's a lot of information goes into those decisions.
There's a lot of information that goes into those decisions.
So let's talk about a big issue, right? Citizens need to know what's going on for snowstorms, right? And particularly the parking issue. Mm-hmm. We talk a lot about this parking issue in this, you know, what you call one side parking. Alternate side parking. Tell me a little bit. I live on Main Street. How do I know when I should park where?
Okay,
how do I know about this, you know?
Alternate side parking, like I said, starts at 7 p.m. at the night, the day of, so today, for example, is the 12th. So at 7 p.m. tonight, you should be parking your car on the even side of the street. It stays on the even side of the street until 7 p.m. tomorrow night, when it should be moved to the odd side of the street. Alternate side parking is in effect for all streets in town unless they're specifically exempt in the alternate side parking regulation, which can be found on the town website. Mm-hmm. So it is complicated because you kind of have to remember it's 7 o'clock today. What's today's date? Okay, I need to be on the even side of the street.
Okay.
When I say even side of the street, it's the street number associated. So you need to look at the house, and if it has an even number street, if it's an even number house, it's 45, then that's odd. 44, you want to be parked on the other side.
So let's make it even easier. It's on websites, right? It's on the town website?
Correct.
If I want to know exactly when my street is and what the situation is, where do I go on the website? Do I go on the Southbridge DPW website? Do I go on a town website? Where
it's
do I find
Southbridge
information?
It's on the Southbridge DPW website under alternate side parking
regulations. Okay, Southbridge Department of Public Works under alternate.
There should be a tab for snow information, and you can click on that.
Snow information, and click on that, and you can look up your street, right?
Well, you'll see the regulation. If your street isn't specifically called out as being exempted from it, then every street is required to do it.
All right, so let's talk about priority streets, because, you know, every street, and I'll tell you what, every street is a priority street from an individual's point of view, but there are more important streets in terms
plowing.
Of main roads and plowing, hospital routes, things like that. Tell me, you know, how does it work with the main roads and routes to the hospital and things like that?
Right.
How do you kind of make them a preference?
Cause we do have priority routes. So as I was alluding to before, sometimes we might not start plowing until there's inch and a half to 2 inches on the ground. In general, that is not true on our main routes, meaning Main Street, the routes around the hospital, our emergency routes, East Main, Main, West Main, any of the main streets coming through town, Central, Elm. We are going to try to keep those streets open and clear of snow as much as possible from when it starts snowing. Main Street, everybody knows, has a pretty good-sized hill coming down it, so we try to keep that scraped as much as possible and treated throughout the storm. It can get really difficult because we can't be everywhere all at the same time. Sometimes the runs take 2 to 3 hours to get around. So if we plow Main Street and we don't get back to it for another hour, at different times, even in our last storm, it was snowing at over an inch an hour. An inch of snow on Main Street Road is going to make it very slippery.
So let's tie in the two, alternate street parking or site parking,
and
Main Streets and stuff. Why do people have to park on one side of the street or the other? What's the issue at hand? Because that's really important. And why are they going to get ticketed if they don't do it? And I want to stress that. You want to pay a lot of attention to this, because if you're on the wrong side of the street or you're parking, you might end up with a ticket from our police department. And we don't, let me clarify, we don't want that to happen. But why would it happen?
So it's very important that, especially our alternate side parking rules are followed, because when it does snow, and even after the snowstorm, In order for the DPW trucks to clean and plow back and push back and be effective and do it in a safe manner so that they don't hit any vehicles or they don't, you know, cause any damage to any vehicles while they're plowing, that the cars are all on the same side of the street. It makes the street wider. It makes it safer for our travel. It makes it safer for other people's travel, less time waiting. We don't have to swerve around vehicles. And it keeps the roads open for any emergency vehicles to get through. You got to remember, if you have a snowbank and cars on both sides of the street and snowbanks on the both sides of the street, a lot of our streets in town, even some of our main streets, are not passable with two cars at a time.
So again, I want to stress this because this is really critical. And a big point of why we wanted to have this meeting now, it's really, really, really important you follow those requirements, because think about those big plow trucks coming up the street with those big blades. They need to be able to get through, and they need to be able to clear the streets. And if they can't, it makes the streets more dangerous for all of us. So
correct.
It's crucial.
It takes us longer to plow.
Yep.
And it won't do as good of a job on the street that we're plowing. We really want to clear out that one side and push the snow back as far as we can so that the next night the cars can move over and then we can follow up and push the snow on the other side back.
So I'm going to tell you, and the result of this is when you don't do it and the cars are there and it slows down our plows and we can't make the seat straight, streets safe, it's causing problems for everybody in town. And you may end up with a ticket from our police department. Please pay attention to this, because if you come to me and say, oh, geez, I got a ticket, I'm going to say, well, we've tried to warn you. It was on TV. It's on our website. This is something you really have to focus closely on, because once you get a ticket, you know, the ticket could be, I think, $75 is what it could be, right?
I'm not sure. It's $50 to $75.
Yeah, it's pretty steep. So please do everything you can to avoid that. Let's keep our roads safe for everybody, make it passable so we can get our kids to school and you guys can all get to work and do the things you want to do. So, again, I want to focus on the
front enders. All during the day, all day long. Yep. It's not just a nighttime regulation. It is in effect at all times.
And we don't do this just for fun. I mean, we do this for you, for the whole town, to make it better and more passable. So snow plowing is a big issue, right? It's really important so we can get our kids to school. Mm-hmm. So tell me about where you plow. Are you involved with plowing out the schools at all? What do you do as it relates to our schools?
The schools actually do plow themselves out. They have their own equipment. Mm-hmm. We treat all the school parking lots and sidewalks. We treat them with our salt so that they're not slippery at that time.
Okay.
So the school department does have their own equipment to plow their schools out. We end up helping with treating.
Okay, so I want to talk about one thing, and I've experienced it myself, and I want to tell you I hate every minute of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
I've just finished, digging out my driveway, and this truck comes along, this big, ugly truck, and it plows in my driveway. Is there any way that can be helped? Can we pick up the plow for every driveway in town?
No, we would never get the roads plowed if we were picking up our plow just to miss everybody's driveway that's already been shoveled out. Unfortunately, I understand. I get it. Nobody wants to have to reshovel the end of their driveway. The best advice I can give you is wait until we're out there resalting those roads. You won't have that windrow come. I know some people want to go to bed and not have to wait any longer. I get it. I understand that completely. But we can't miss every driveway in town. We try very hard to not put snow on a sidewalk.
Yeah.
We definitely try very hard not to do that. We're only human, though, so if a mistake does happen. But we definitely try, but we cannot prevent...
I got to tell you, folks, it's interesting because I actually get calls from people who say, the DPW driver hates me, keeps plowing in my driveway. Believe me, they don't hate you. They're not trained to do it on purpose. They just need to go through and clear the roads, and it's part of the job. There's no way they can turn their blades for every house or lift their blades. They'd never finish the road. So they do it, for the good of the safety of all the residents, and I do appreciate that. It's a pain to keep shoveling that out. So just wait till the end. Leave a little pasture, and at the very end of the storm, that's when you do your shoveling, as Heather says, especially when the sand and salt trucks come, because then they're not going to plow because they want the material to be down. So,
the end of the storm, when we're retreating the roads, is the time to start, especially at the end of your driveway. The rest of your driveway, go at it, and I'd leave that end right so you know that we were already up there.
Now, I'm not sure about this. Can residents get salt or anything? Some departments, DPW departments have... you know, salt yep. they can use for their private driveways. Is that available here?
Yes, we have a salt sand mixture that's mm-hmm. housed in a covered area. It you can access it right off of Gulfwood Road. If you pass the building, there's a little covered kiosk. You walk through the fence and shovel it into a bucket, and you can have it's free to the residents.
So this is not within the fence, is it?
It's an own fenced-in area. You don't come into the yard. You actually drive by, and you pull over after you. There's a covered kiosk, I'd call it, area. There's a roof over a small open-sided building, and the salt.
So it's kind of past your facility, because I know you need to have this special thing to get into
right.
your facility.
It's past the facility,
so you go right
so you
past
can get
it.
It.
It's on
the
left-hand
side,
side
of the road.
There's a little fenced-in area where this sanding stuff is,
yep,
and if you need salt and sand to do your driveway, you can get it free right there at that location.
Mm-hmm.
That's great news, and I'm not sure if everybody knows that. So it's really good news. And if you're like me, what you do is you get a bucket before the storm. You keep it at your house, and then when it's you, know, you see the storm coming, you throw some down a little bit in the beginning of the storm like they do on the roads, and then you put some after you shovel it off, and it gives you, it's just easier to do your driveway.
Some melting.
Yeah, it gives some melting. So do we need to talk about any more about snow, or do we cover most of it?
I think we covered most of it. The only other thing I would like to say is the snow emergencies. When there is a snow emergency issued, there's multiple different locations that you can find it. But the easiest place to find it is it will always be on the town's website, right in the banner in bright red letters when you open up the town website.
So what does snow emergency mean to residents? What does that mean? They see a banner, it says snow. What does that mean?
Snow emergency means on the snow emergency routes, there is no parking at all allowed.
It's no alternate side. It's no parking.
It's no parking. And the town provides and allows residents to park in town-owned lots until the storm is
over. So is Main Street and the storm is going on? Is Main Street one of those?
Main Street is one of those. So is Central. Hamilton, they're mm-hmm. all snow emergency routes. There's a list of snow emergency routes on that same alternate side parking bulletin.
Okay.
And the locations for parking are also listed, but they're the Central Street lot, they're the Edward Street lot, so on both sides of Main Street. Marcy Street at Wells, we're still allowing people to park over there, and the R&V lot.
So the purpose is to keep a clear route to the hospital for
right.
It's key locations in town where no matter what, we need to have that width. We need to have safe passage too. It's mostly just on main kind of streets, right?
It's on a main kind of street, correct.
Okay, that's good news. So we got to pay attention to that. Again, it's on the DPW website, and there's a banner that says snow emergency.
Right.
And know if your road is one of those roads, you want to know it, because if you park on either side of the street, you're in trouble then.
And all the snow emergency routes are also posted with signs that say snow emergency routes.
Okay. So again, we wanted to kind of help you out with this. The snowstorms, I'm afraid we're going to get a few more of these things by the time this winter. Yeah. You know, all me and Heather think about is, please don't snow, because it costs us money in our budget, and it's you know, you got to have guys and come out in the middle of the night. It's just, we would love to have, you know, no snow for the rest of the year.
We
spend a lot of time looking at weather reports this time of year, don't we?
We do, yes.
So anyway, that's one of the main issues of what DPW does, Department of Public Works. But there's a whole host of others that we want to talk about. I'm going to talk about roads in general. I hear more about what is described as the crummy condition mm-hmm. of the roads here in Southbridge. Yes, we know that's true. I want to talk a little bit to explain why that's true. And, you know, a lot of people go, well, the DPW department's not doing their job. How come we don't pave roads? Well, let's talk about that. Heather, how come we just don't go out and pave roads all the time and put down nice layers
brand
of
new
pavement.
Roads.
Yeah, it'd be really nice. I would like
I would
that.
Love brand new roads all over the town.
So why don't we do it?
It's always about money.
Money.
Unfortunately, we only get one primary source of our road paving funds is our Chapter 90 funds, and that comes from the state of Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
We don't really budget other than for small patches from when we do utility work for any other road repairs.
So mostly, almost none of the money we use to work on roads comes from local tax dollars, does it?
Correct.
It comes from state funds. And about how much do we get each year in state funds?
We get somewhere between around $600,000 to $800,000 a year.
$600,000 or $800,000 every year we get. Well, that sounds like a lot of money. How much road
that
pavement
really
could you do if you just pave the road? How much could you do?
A lot of pavement. That right. does less. I'm going to, you know, to reconstruct a complete road, which many of our roads need complete reconstruction, mm-hmm. meaning bring them right back down to subbase and start over again, that doesn't even do a mile of road.
Not even a mile of road. So you think about all the miles of road we have in town, we couldn't even do a mile of road a year with the money we get from the state. So we don't really do a mile of road, do we? What do we do with that money? Because we, you know, if we fix one road, we have to let every other road in town go bad. So what do we really do with that money?
We have a program.
How do we do it? How do we make that money stretch out as far as we can?
We've instituted a program for crack sealing. And what crack sealing does is where our roads have started to form cracks, we seal those cracks, preventing more water from getting down into the road and deteriorating them further. It actually prolongs the life of a road so that we don't have to repave it as much. In addition, what we do is we'll also, if there's areas that are really bad, one small section of a road, we might cut that section out and just patch that section. We do some overlays. We did some overlays on South Street to try to extend the life of that road. And then what we'll do is some of the funds we'll save so that we can do a big road project, like we've been talking about doing South Street. West Street's another one on our list. And we will do a larger project when we accumulate some of those funds, because those funds do not go away from year to year.
So folks, what happens, so to kind of just rephrase it, because I think it's important you understand, is instead of taking that $600,000 to $800,000 and fixing one road, we patch roads all throughout town, we crack seal them. And what this does is it makes all of our roads last a little longer, so we get more time for each of our existing roads. The sad part about that is you don't see any new paved roads, although there's a few minor exceptions to that. We were able to use some what we call CDBG block grant. It's a block grant that came into town, and we were able to use a little bit of that money in certain targeted areas of town to fix roads.
Correct.
And that's up near our community center, right?
We did Chestnut Street up near the community center, and Warren Lane was done also, right up near the community center. And the rest of Chestnut Street will be redone next year, along with Overland. So we've redone those roads. And since I've been here, we've done road work on Brookside and Charlton Street, Torrey Road, and a couple roads over near the Henry Street Fields to improve over there.
This is what they call community block grant money that comes in from the state, and it's set up to targeted areas of town, essentially poorer areas of town. So it can't just be used in any part of town. It's usually in towns that need more, or areas of town that need more help. That's how come we're able to get away with that. Let's talk a little bit about South Street, because, you know, we don't use much in terms of tax dollars, but last year we were able to put $300,000 of what we call free cash, sort of like a surplus from the year before, and we are going to apply that to add to some Chapter 90 or state money for roads, so we could fix a section of South Street, which is really, really critical. Tell me a little bit about that project.
So South Street is, whether people are aware, we have two main transmission mains that come down South Street, water transmission mains that come down South Street that need to be replaced. When the replacement of those water mains occurs, that's going to be a big water project that's under in the planning stages, we'll be replacing the pavement on South Street and drainage on South Street.
So the water pipes run underneath the road. So while we're fixing the water pipes, we'll use this money to fix the road and do it nicely.
Correct. It will be one large project. It will cause some disruption in the upper sections of South Street. But when we're done, a lot of the complaints that we get, I would say all the complaints we get about how bad South Street condition-wise is, will be gone. Yeah.
You know, it's interesting. I get business leaders. I have town councilors who go, how come we can't fix the roads? And it's a hard thing for me to keep saying, well, because I don't have any money. Now, the truth is we can continue to raise taxes and use some more tax money towards roads, but it's been difficult to do because we're trying to make up for money we're going to lose potentially by the closing of our landfill. So it's not like we have extra millions of dollars we can use for road work. So we're going to try to fix the problem with the Casella money, try to get off of that money from Casella, and hopefully after that we can do more about targeting roads and stuff. So we have, believe it or not, the interesting thing is we have a very well thought out plan for what roads should be paved and how they should be paved. Problem is we don't have money to back up that plan. So
that's correct.
Kudos to you for developing that plan, for setting it all up, and we know what roads we have to do. We have an order for that. We know some of the costs involved with that. The big issue is we don't have the money to actually do
it. It's funding.
Yeah, no. All right, so that's the general road condition area. So let's bounce to another topic, and we touched on it lightly. Let's talk about water. One of the great things that I learned since I've come to Southbridge, we have a great water supply. We have awesome reservoirs. So tell me a little bit about the water in town. Do you run the water department? Who runs the water department? How does that all work?
Okay. So the water department is operated by a contract operator called Whitewater, and I oversee the operations of the Whitewater. Their contract comes under my department. They work right in our buildings. They're actually housed right in the DPW office, and they have the water filtration plant where it actually we treat the water. So I work hand in hand with them on a daily basis on water issues. And we were very fortunate that sometime long ago, probably over about 150 years ago, they planned out a water system with protected reservoirs. Mm-hmm. So we own many acres of land up in what we call our watershed area, which is up off of South Street, up in the corner of the town. There is a 4-reservoir system right adjacent to our plant that we take our water from, and then we have another reservoir system over off of Eastford Road that there's another large reservoir, dammed water, looks like a beautiful lake that we can take drinking water from. Once the drinking water comes into our plant, we have a 3-filter plant that can treat our water. The water is treated, goes into a storage tank for chlorine, for contact for chlorine, and then goes out into the system.
Now, this summer, we had a water ban. And it's interesting because I know we have plenty of water in our reservoirs. So, you know, the issue is the water was lower than it normally is,
correct,
right? So the water levels at the reservoir were below normal levels. And in the rest of the area who are not as fortunate to have as much water in their water as ours, they have bigger problems.
Correct.
But we also had the water ban. And it's because our levels were low and we don't know how long they're going to keep going down. Because
right,
they're going in a bad direction.
So we
had to institute the ban as well, right?
Right. The state of Massachusetts and really the whole Northeast region has been in a drought for drought conditions for the last 18 months, probably a little over that now. Even with our recent rains, we've done better, but the state of Massachusetts still has us in a drought. Mm-hmm. And with that, they asked us to put limits on our water use and have a water ban, so no outside watering, to take conservation methods for any outside water use, up to and including, they asked us not to flush our water system this year, which is normally part of regular maintenance, because of the concerns of the water ban. In the recent last month, with the snow and the rainstorms we have gotten, I can happily report our water reservoir they're starting to recover. We've actually seen the amount of water in them increase, but that really wasn't the case for all of the summer. All of last year, it was a steady decline in our water reservoirs if you looked at it over time. So I'm very happy that we're up to about 80%. We had gotten as low as 70%, which is pretty low. I won't be really happy until they are over 90%. Usually by the end of the winter, we're operating at 100% capacity.
So it's not the town of Southbridge going, okay, we're going to have a water ban. It really is a recommendation of the State Department of Environmental Protection, who kind of calls us up and say, you know, we really need you to do a water ban. We're trying to protect the watershed in the whole entire area, not just Southbridge. We need you to participate in this to make sure that, you know, water is available to the entire area, right?
Right.
Okay. So one of the good things was when we did the water rate increase and we were looking at the increases for, as everybody knows, costs go up every year, so prices go up on everything. Water only went up by 1%. It was very, very minor. And usually, I guess what happens is sometimes we do these big capital projects, like we're talking about South Street. We got to rip up the water lines. We have to go out and borrow money to do that. So that raises our rates. But this year it only went up 1%. Really good news for people because we have a good water supply. Our water equipment is in pretty good shape. We don't need major repairs to the water facility. Right. I mean, that's pretty much what we're talking about.
Right. And in general, we're the water system is in very good condition. We have some pipes and some mains that we will do capital projects on in the next 10 years to replace. We'll look at some different issues of what we can do with our plant to make incremental upgrades. Mm-hmm. But we're lucky that our water plant is really not very old. We just added a new filter 6-7 years ago, so we have 3 filters. We have enough filtration capacity. It's operating really well. We meet our permit, and we have really, really high quality water. Mm-hmm. So in that way, we're in good shape on the water side.
So water rates, the reason water rates might go up is because you're doing capital projects, right? You're investing in the system. You're putting in new pipes. Right. It costs money. You might have to rip a road up to get right. to the pipes. That's, you know, if you were to do some improvement at the water facility, you have to pay for those projects. And that's what really gets into the rate increases, is how to pay for making sure our system stays in the same quality it is, right?
Right.
Okay. Well, I wanted to point that out. You know why I wanted to point that out, right? Because now we're going to talk about sewer.
Yeah, we're not in such a great boat with our sewer system.
Yeah, sewer and water are a completely different situation. So we have an old sewer treatment facility, and it needs a lot of repairs. Correct. It needs a lot of work, a lot of capital projects going. So our rate was much higher, somewhere up in the 8-9% area, because we have so much work to do to bring our sewer capacity up and improve our plan and do things to help hopefully reduce smell. Tell me a little bit about our sewer treatment plant, because that's okay. a really important issue.
Our sewer treatment plant, the majority of it was built over 30 years ago, and a lot of our equipment there is over 30 years old. So we've been doing some upgrades and looking at redesigning some of our plant to make sure that our plant can continue to operate and meet permit.
DEP permit.
DEP right. discharge permit.
Discharge permit, right.
So we have a couple different projects that are currently in the design stage and semi in construction. We did some construction over the last year to prepare for our next big construction project. We have to do a chemical addition system to meet permit for phosphorus removal. Mm-hmm. And then we are actually also upgrading our dewatering equipment for our sludge. So the dewatering equipment for our sludge that we currently have is over 30 years old. They're called belt filter presses. And we have basically used the parts from one to keep the other one going. So it's to the point where it's a critical need, and we're very concerned about it. The phosphorus chemical addition system, we've been using temporary systems in the summer, which we actually house outside and have temporary tanks outside. But it's going to be a permit requirement that we have to do that full time. So we have to be able to do that in the winter. We can't house chemicals and have temporary chemical lines on the ground in the winter. In addition, we've been doing upgrades to what we call our bio towers, because maybe some of you have seen my picture slide presentation where our bio towers actually have sprung leaks, and we had some concerns that those are going to continue to leak and cause problems that we might not be able to use them.
So for some of us, bio tower, what that's a bio tower?
Yes.
It sounds like a scientific
big box,
experience,
right?
Or something. Yeah,
well, it is a scientific experiment. It is a steel structure that's basically a couple stories high, that the water trickles down the inside over a medium, which is, in this case, it's a wood medium, and that wood medium grows a biogrowth on it, a biological growth, and that biological growth is what cleans the wastewater. Mm-hmm. It takes the biological material out of the wastewater and eats it up and cleans it. So it's a critical step in our process to make sure that our water meets the discharge permit, but it's a biological process. Without having that to be operational, it would be much more difficult for us to treat and meet permit.
Right. So people have to understand, you know, we all know what goes in our sewer system, right? It flows out of our sewer system, and it ends up in a treatment plant. And people will sometimes, I guess if you want to know where it is, it's down near the big Y.
Most people know where it is.
Yeah, you kind of know where it is if you go there. But it's down behind the big Y, and all of the fluids from the sewer systems goes into this plant. And it's basically broken down, is what it, I guess
it's
it is.
It's treated and broken down in different methods
using, you know, like I said, this
biology
and stuff.
It's biological methods and chemical addition methods to remove and settle any chemicals.
Yeah. So basically all of the material is kind of drains out. She refers to it as sludge. It's a byproduct of our waste
treatment.
Is what it is. And it was fascinating because, as most of you know, cow manure is used for a fertilizer, right? And everybody is used cow manure, horse manure in gardens and things like that. Well, guess what? It also, I didn't know, is used from human waste, is also used as a fertilizer product. Tell me a little bit about that.
We have what's called composting of our sludge. So after our sludge is dewatered, it is mixed with wood chips in a specific method. It is allowed to basically cook. It's not cooked. It cooks under its own biological activity to get to a certain temperature for a certain number of days. And then it's tested to make sure that there's no human pathogens, which are diseases, in it, or any meets certain standards for chemicals and human pathogens. And then it's sold as compost. It is meets all grades to be used as on human gardens, on anywhere that humans would exist. We actually are able to, I won't say sell, but we are able to use it as a beneficial reuse product where we get a small amount return from different composting companies that sell it.
So instead of having a cost to dispose of that sludge, we actually turn around and sell it for composting for gardens and stuff, and it doesn't cost us as much to get rid
Correct.
Of it. It's what I would call a cost reduction more than a revenue, right?
Right.
Instead of having to pay to get rid of the material, you're able to give it away cheap or cheaper than what it would cost to throw it away, and it's used for different landscaping projects and things like that. It was something I was unaware of, so I was kind of surprised because
actually,
in my hometown, they actually incinerate it and they burn it. Here we have
any Southbridge resident can go and get ready compost for themselves for free.
There you go. If you want compost in that way, it's just I have a hard time with my mind on that, but that's my own that's my own problem, so to speak. So the sewer rates have gone up more, and the reason it's going up is more is because we're trying to take different components of this old sewer treatment facility and upgrade them, and even sewer lines are part of that. Any capital improvement to upgrade this old facility, we have to figure out how to pay for it, and that's why sewer rates are going up way faster than things like water rates. And then once you fix that building up, the water building will get older, and we'll be, you know, it's a constant battle to keep our facilities in the best shape to provide the best services we can to residents.
In addition, our sewer lines below ground are in worse shape than our water lines. Some of them over 100 years old, and they're, you know, we are always looking at what we call I&I, which is inflow and infiltration, and trying to reduce our I&I flows. And that's also part of our permit, that we have to reduce our I&I flows and have a plan to do it. So we're always looking at grouting and sealing and putting liners in, and we're inspecting pipes and trying to find places where maybe storm sewers are connected into our sanitary sewer, which they shouldn't be, and trying to repair those, or even where just groundwater is seeping into our sewer system that causes us to have wide variety of flow swings. Our normal flows at our wastewater treatment plant are under 2 million gallons a day. When we have very wet weather and have big rainstorms, they can go over 10 million gallons per day. And treating something like that becomes a real impact.
You know, Heather, one of the things that I know you're an engineer by trade, that you came up through the engineering field. I know we hired another person that has engineering background. It seems a lot of what happens at our Department of Public Works is engineering, getting ready to, it's designing things, right? So you're designing, it could be designing an area of a road or a bridge or things like that. Tell me a little bit about what that means to be, and why did you have to be an engineer, and why is that helpful in what your job is?
Well, a lot of what I do is very technical based. So even if I'm not designing it, somebody else is designing it, and I need to be able to communicate with them on their same level so that we know what we're getting for a product, for a service. So it can be very technical in nature, or it can be just the way we think about things and approach a problem. I'm very analytical. Try to have everything mapped out. You know, we talked about pavement management. We look and we have a plan. We have a plan that's going forward on our water and our wastewater plant so that we know that we're already planning ahead for what the next step is. That's a trait that you kind of pick up in engineering school about planning and knowing where the projects are going. It's not something you learn in a class as much as that you learn that this is how you have to plan it out to be able to get these projects done. We're talking about a lot of money that we have to spend on these projects, so you want to make sure that they're done in the most cost-effective way and that we get the biggest benefit for our buck.
Heather, I know before I got here you were what we call an interim DPW director. In other words, you weren't the formal DPW director, and I think you served as an interim about 3 years. Is that right?
Correct.
Well, first, I know that the Southbridge Town Council has been very supportive of DPW and other departments trying to improve the quality of services for our citizens. I know DPW has been supportive of the DPW department, trying to give you appropriate resources. And it's a lot of work. I want you to know that we all appreciate all the hard work you do for the people of Southbridge. We know that. And we know that some of the problems we have here in town, like the conditions of the road, are not really reflective of what you do. It's reflective of that we just don't have enough money, enough resources to give you the tools you need. So we do know you're facing kind of an uphill kind of battle. But we gave you a new assistant engineer that we were missing for a long time. Your staff, I think, is pretty well organized. Tell me about your team. You know, you're part of your team. Yep. What kind of team do you have, and what do you think about the team you have to go into the future with them?
I think we have a very good team in place. You spoke about, so basically I look at our department as having three sections. I have a water operations group, which is Whitewater. I have a wastewater operations group that is managed by Veolia, and then I have my operations team. So there would be me with Matt as my deputy engineer, a deputy director, and then Tara is our administrator, and then under me is also Ron Trudeau, who is our operations manager, who runs our operations crew. He is a foreman who helps him run the crew and fills in when he's not there, and then we have two crew chiefs and a variety of staffs, including mechanics and janitorial and just general heavy equipment maintenance men, or heavy equipment operators and then maintenance men. So we have a wide variety of skills and trades, and every one of them has their own little specialty, and we try to maximize what we have to be able to do as much as we can for the town. There's always more demands being put on us. We have lots of parks and recs that we handle. We have lots of roads. We have lots of catch basins and stormwater systems. So we're always trying to maneuver to be able to get the most of what we can do out of the staff that we have on.
She smiles because she knows I'm constantly picking up the phone going, Heather, I need this. Can you fit this into this schedule that's already overwhelming? You know, the fence is falling at one of the parks, or I need some trees, branches cut down, or what?
Or we have a leak in town hall, and town we don't know where it is. Town hall roof is leaking, and
Heather's what we call the jack of all trades here in town, and it's constantly like that. I'm going to take 2 minutes because I want to point out a guy who works hard. You know, our operational foreman, Ron Trudeau, is a really talented guy, and he's the sort of jack of all trades. He's the guy who knows everything about the roads and how to take care of different things. He kind of runs the crew. So compliments to Ron. I think he's somebody that...
He is somebody that I have heavily relied on all the time I have been here, and without him, this department would not run as smoothly as it does. Yeah. He is the key to making sure that everything gets done on a clockwork basis. He's always reminding me of, hey, we have this coming up. We have to think about this. Can you get this notice out? He makes sure that on a day-to-day basis, whatever needs to be done that day-to-day or week-to-week is done, that the parks get mowed, that the roads get swept, that whatever it is, he is making sure that the staff is out there doing it.
Well, Heather, I want to thank you for being on this show, to helping to tell people a little bit about the DPW department. I want to thank you for all you do and for putting up with all the phone calls I give you on a host of different issues. We know your job is challenging, but we know you're doing a heck of a job within the resources we give you.
So
thank you for all your hard work on behalf of the town. And I want to thank you, the viewers of this show. I hope that this gave you a little bit more information about our Department of Public Works building and all the different services they provide, and lets you know, more importantly, how your tax dollars are being spent. You know what? We're trying our best to spend them in the most efficient manner possible and to give you the best quality services for every dollar. So, again, thank you for enjoying it, celebrating Southbridge, and have a great day. So that was it.